Chapter 11 of The Gentle Art of Faking by Riccardo Nobili. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Jordan Watts, Oxfordshire. Chapter 11, Mazarin as a Collector. Collectors of the 17th century in France. Louis XIII. Richelieu. Mazarin and his advisers. Louis XIV as an art lover. Vaillant's strange case. Sanson, the hangman, collecting pictures. The second collection of Cardinal Mazarin. Its partial destruction through the Cardinal's nephew. The Médaille Ancelon under Louis XIV. Epigrams on collectors. Duke of Orleans' ill-fated collection. We must now give our attention to France as the most prominent country in all that concerns collections of art, because the same conditions appear here that are vanishing from Italy. In the 17th century, Paris had a well-established market of antiquities, authentic and spurious masterpieces, articles of virtu, etc. They were also collectors of all types, dealers and the whole assemblage of wise and foolish, honest and dishonest, peculiar to the commerce when it finds its proper market. Broadly speaking, in the 17th century, every Parisian seems to have been a collector of something or other. Painting, as a rule, is given the preference. It is about this time that Italy, however rich through the daily excavation of antique works of sculpture, no longer seemed to suffice the greedy demand of France. Paris sent his emissaries to Mount Athos, Syria and Africa in search of finds. Tavernier, Thévenet, Lucas, Chardin and Galland scoured the world in quest for antiquities and rarities both for themselves and for the King of France. Vaillant, one of the most efficient of these hunters, went to the East, sent by Louis XIV, who too has joined the ring of collectors and in a kingly way played the role of art amateur. On his return journey, Vaillant was caught by pirates, but managing to escape, embarked for Europe. On the way to France, the vessel for the second time met the corsairs. They were seen in the distance and were expected to attack at any moment. The ship was able to escape, but fearing to be caught again and of losing the valuable collections of coins and medals he was bringing to Europe, Vaillant swallowed 20 of the best pieces in order to save them from any possible danger of being taken. This odd story, with its consequences, is related in detail by Monsieur Weiss in his Biographie Universelle, with such French frankness as to forbid any attempt at translation. Besides monarchs, the princes, noblemen and simple middle class of all conditions seem to be collectors at this period. The passion for collecting numbers names such as Richelieu and Mazarin among antiquaries, amateurs and dealers, were Jabach and others. The number and importance of art collections, as well as of intelligent art lovers in France during the 17th century, can be gathered from the many publications on this century. They are many, and most of the contemporary ones are quite documentary and important for the number of collectors they mention. We may quote among them the Itinerarium Galliae, 1612, by Just Zinzeling, a German signing himself Jodocus Sincerus, Abraham Gollnitz's Ulysses Belgico Gallico, a work written in 1631 dealing with the collection of medals and painting that the author found in France during his journey. There is also the Voyage pour l'instruction et les commodités tantes de François Couleur étranger, printed in 1639 and reprinted by Verdier, with interesting additions, in the year 1687. John Evelyn, the English diarist, visited France in the year 1643 and gave an account of many collections of art and their cabinets, which was partially republished in the Voyage de Lister, in an edition of the year 1878. We can enumerate further the Traité du plus belle bibliothèque, published for the first time in 1644 by Père Louis Jacob, the Librarian of Cardinal de Retz and of President du Halley, the Liste anonyme des cueilleurs de diverses villes, etc. In these works, thousands of names of collectors of art, whether specialists or not, are mentioned, not only those residing in Paris, but in all towns in the provinces. Collector mania was becoming epidemic. The list of 17th century collectors of art has the odd honour of including the name of Charles Sanson, the hangman of Paris, and great-grandfather of the celebrated Sanson, the executioner of the haute œuvre at the time of the French Revolution. According to information given by Grammont, who related to the French king his adventures with Sanson, the man who had been nominated public executioner in Paris by a decision of Parliament dated August 11th, 1688, possibly the first Sanson to enter the undesirable profession, this man was not only a collector of paintings but also a specialist, and logically so. Grammont relates how he was one day hunting for paintings in the fair of Saint-Germain when he came across Sanson with Forest, a painter and art dealer. The hangman was haggling over the price of a few works he wished to add to his collection. One of the canvases represented a wife mercilessly scourging her husband. Another was the portrait of Monsieur Tardieu, the deceased lieutenant criminel, a man Sanson had known very well and to whom he owed a certain gratitude, because, as he remarked to Grammont, when living he had made him hang and torture so many people that his skill and efficiency were gained through the work done in Monsieur Tardieu's time. A third painting he finally decided to buy represented Japanese torturing several missionaries to death. He candidly declared that spectacles of this kind appeared charming to him and that he intended to hang the painting in his bedroom. A characteristic of the latter part of the 17th century is not only the many sales of collections of art in France, England and elsewhere, but the appearance for the first time of printed catalogues, prepared either for the sale or as a simple illustrative document of certain collections. The first printed catalogue of France bears the title Rue de Médaille et autres antiquités du cabinet de Monsieur Dupré, gentilhomme d'Aix. And after this, many collectors followed the example. Even the learned Marol is tempted to give the public his Catalogue de Livres d'Estampes et de Figures de Taille Douce. To complete the characteristics of the revived market of antiques and articles of virtue in France, now exuberant in its various expressions, we may note the advent of the so-called amateur marchand. The private dealer, a gentleman with a collection who deals secretly in antiques, and at the same time plays the grand seigneur scorning commerce, has been perfected since, and the modern one is perhaps more intelligent, shrewder, more the grand seigneur, but less frank and far more dangerous. It may be said, by the way, that the art critic has not yet put in an appearance as a disguised dealer, the wardrobe of the ambiguous trade not having yet supplied the mask. There was no representative at this time for the type of Pietro Aretino, why not call him one of this species, who in the 16th century extolled paintings for artists in exchange for paintings and sold his literary eulogies to princes and monarchs. One of the most characteristic collectors of the epoch is, perhaps, Mazarin, a merchant and intriguer of the one side, and on the other, a passionate collector and an epic type of the lover of art. A brief sketch of his life and the vicissitudes of his collections of art are worth giving. Mazarin, in a way, so thoroughly impersonates his time that to portray him as a collector helps to throw light on the milieu in which he lived. History handed Mazarin down to us as a politician and capital intriguer, etc., but only a few know of him as a lover of art. As a collector, Mazarin recalls the shrewdest kind of the old Roman type. The times are changed, and the old ways of Sulla and Mark Antony no longer possible. Violence and proscription lists would not be tolerated, but without the extreme methods of a Roman proconsul, Mazarin possesses the cunning of a Verres. Like the latter, he also finds things by instinct and has the unbounded passion of a true collector. We are uncertain at times whether Mazarin, who was without doubt one of the most appreciative collectors of his day, possessed that rare sixth sense which goes under the name of the collector's touch. But he was nevertheless a man of taste and an art lover of unusual promptitude in the usage of the abilities of others. Like many a genuine and greedy collector of Roman times, Mazarin was persistent and obdurate in the carrying through of the most complex and discouraging plans in order to secure objects for his collection. In Rome once he saw a painting of Correggio, the Sposalizio. It belonged to Cardinal Barberini, who had made up his mind never to part with the masterpiece. To become possessed of it, Mazarin made use of a ruse. He asked Anne of Austria to demand the painting from Cardinal Barberini, knowing that stubborn as the cardinal might be, he would not refuse a favour to the Queen of France. In fact, Barberini came to Paris himself to present the painting to Anne of Austria. The epilogue of this Mazarinade is related by Brienne as follows. To do proper honour to the gift, the Queen hung the picture in her bedroom in the presence of Cardinal Barberini, but hardly had he left "Il n'eut pas les dos tournés" than she took the painting and gave it to Mazarin. Brienne ends his account with the observation that Mazarin had conducted this lengthy intrigue to get possession of a picture. Considering that intriguing was second nature with Mazarin, we must say that Correggio's Sposalizio was worth the trouble of such a Mazarinade. As a collector of art, bric-a-brac and precious things generally, Cardinal Mazarin had an unusually lucky career. Contrary to the rule that exacts a very high price for experience in collecting, Mazarin seems to have been favoured by fortune from the very first. As for scruples, if they are known to a few connoisseurs, he had none. He was scarcely known. His profession, if his occupation may be so called, was to move between Rome and Paris, to play to a certain extent the part of a courier between the two cities, the navette, weaver's shuttle, between the Roman state and its intriguers in Paris. During this period of his life, Mazarin used to land in the French capital at the house of the Chavignys, where he often arrived covered all over with dirt, tout crotté. Passing Monferrato on one of his journeys, he bought ambrosiae, the beads of which were supposed to be glass, but were in fact precious stones, emeralds, sapphires, rubies and diamonds. The rosary Mazarin bought for a mere song was sold in Paris for 10,000 ducats. His reputation as an excellent bric-a-brac hunter with a fine eye for works of art reached Richelieu, and this secured Mazarin the protection of the omnipotent cardinal. The rest is known. Mazarin really remained a private dealer all his life, a fact that his opponents could not forget. More than one Mazarinade alludes to the cardinal's dealings. Even when writing to potentates or diplomats on the most important political schemes, Mazarin never lost sight of his hobby. In his letter to Cardinal Grimaldi on the importance of watching our affairs in Italy, he reminds him, by the way, to be on the lookout for good books and good paintings, etc. Through a well-organized network of agents and political friends, he received objects for his collection almost daily, chiefly from Rome, Florence and other cities of Italy. Statues, paintings, furniture arrived at a continual stream at the Cardinal's palace. His library numbered 12,000 volumes in a very short time. The Fronde, however, is no longer satisfied with jibing the Cardinal with Mazarinades on his buying of books without being able to read them. His opponents, antagonistic to the Cardinal's policy, finally rose up boldly against him. Mazarin was obliged to fly from Paris. By a decree of Parliament, his goods were seized and sold. Whatever criticism may be passed on the Cardinal's shady policy, the destruction of his collection and library is an unpardonable sin and an artistic loss. Mazarin does not seem to have been discouraged by this unexpected contretemps. Learning that Diabach was going to London to be present at the sale of the collection of Charles I, he asked him to buy paintings for him, and through this friend he was able to secure for a new gallery the Venus by Titian, the Antiope and the Marsyas by Correggio, the Deluge by Carracci, as well as tapestries of inestimable value. 2 years later, Mazarin triumphantly entered Paris again, was reinstated in his former power, and started a new library while reconstituting his dispersed gallery. And when he died, his collection contained, according to an inventory of the year 1661, 546 pictures, of which 283 were of the Italian school, 77 German or Dutch, 77 French, and 109 of various schools. The Italian school included names such as Raphael, Titian, Correggio, Tintoretto, Solario, Guido Reni, the Carracci, Domenichino, Bassano, Albani, etc. Many of these works are now in the Louvre Museum, and nearly all his statues, 350 in number, have also passed to the Louvre and are now kept in the Galerie d'Antique. The inventory also informs us that the Cardinal left 21 cabinets, some in ebony, others veneered with tortoiseshell and ivory, and a large quantity of marble tables and Venetian glass, chandeliers in rock crystal, and irons in silver or gilded. The precious stones were valued at 387,014 francs, the silver of the chapel at 25,995, the plates in silver, gold or gilded, 761 pieces, at 347,972, etc. The same inventory also notes 411 fine pieces of tapestry, estimated at 632,000, perhaps not a single piece of the best would cost nowadays, but an enormous sum considering the time. There were also 46 Persian rugs of unusual length, 21 complete ameublons in velvet, satin, gold embroidered silk, etc. The library included 50,000 volumes and 400 manuscripts. Brienne, who was a collector himself on a smaller scale, and who filled at the time the position of secretary to the cardinal, relates with a certain pathos the last moments of this frantic art collector, and how during his last illness he grieved to leave his cherished masterpieces. "I was walking," says Brienne, "in the small gallery in which is the woolen tapestry representing Scipio. The cardinal did not possess a finer one. By the noise of his slippers, I heard him coming, shuffling along like a suffering man or a convalescent. I hid myself behind the tapestry and heard him say, 'I must leave all this.' Being very weak, he stopped at every step, leaning first to one side and then to the other, gazing at the various objects of his collection. And in a voice that came from his heart, he kept on repeating, 'I must leave all this,' then turning his head to another side, 'And also that. What trouble I had to buy all these things. How can I leave them without regret? I shall not be able to see them where I am going.' I gave a sigh. I could not help it, and he heard me. 'Who is there?' 'It is I, Monsignor.' 'Come here,' he said to me in a doleful tone. He was nude, only covered with his robe de chambre de camelot, lined with petit gris. He said, 'Give me your hand. I am so weak. I can hardly bear it.' Then returned to his first idea. 'Do you see, my friend, that fine painting by Correggio, that Venus by Titian, and that incomparable deluge by Carracci? I know that you too love and understand painting. Alas, my dear friend, I must leave all this. Goodbye, dear paintings that I have loved so much, that have cost me so high a price.' Brienne, Memoirs, Book 2, Chapter 14. These three paintings, Correggio's Sposalizio, Titian's Venus, and Carracci's work, are now in the Louvre Museum. Que j'ai tant aimé et qui m'ont tant coûté. The second part of the sad exclamation would indeed seem to belong to this shrewd adventurer, but those not knowing to what lengths the passion for collecting can go would hardly imagine that a man of Mazarin's temperament could love, really love, anything on earth but power and intrigue. As a most remarkable contrast to this passionate love for beautiful things, destiny ordains that the greater part of the cardinal's statues and paintings should fall into the hands of his nephew and heir, Armand Charles de Laporte, Duc de la Meilleraye, the husband of Mazarin's niece, Hortense Mancini. This nephew, who on becoming the cardinal's heir was allowed to take his uncle's name and titles, was bigoted to the last degree. Idiotically deprived of all artistic sense, he thought it was his duty to destroy the art collection, to purge the world of the offence offered to morality by nude sculpture, to rid society of the cardinal's paintings with their shocking mythological subjects. Saint-Evremont relates how this fanatic iconoclast left his mansion at Vincennes one day with the deliberate intention to destroy the fine gallery left to him by the cardinal, and how on his arrival in Paris he entered the place where it was kept, and taking a hammer out of the mason's hand, proceeded to smash statue after statue and destroy paintings. But the statues and works of art were altogether too many to be destroyed single-handed, so he armed half a dozen servants with hammers and ordered them to help him in his artistic hecatomb. It was indeed fortunate that upon the cardinal's death Louis XIV made up his mind to buy some of the best paintings, and that some of the statues had also been taken away from this strange curator of Mazarin's museum, or there would be very little left today of one of the most famous collections of Paris. Some of the statues now in the Louvre still show this fanatic nobleman's abuse of the hammer, more especially the one bearing the title Le Génie du Repos Éternel. The monarchs of this time bought paintings, statues and fine things, sharing enthusiasm with private citizens. However, they played their part well and the attitude of the art lover gave them a finishing touch. Yet in less dangerous and despotic an age, the pen of a Molière might have tried its caustic ability on some of these types. Louis XIII is, after all, but a mild art lover, at least so he appears by the side of Marie de Medici, who learned the part of Maecenas at the court of Tuscany. He collects arms and has a cabinet of choice weapons. Among other curios, his Grosse Vitry, a carbine of rare merit left him by Vitry. We know of this collection of Louis XIII because it is recorded that when Concini, the Florentine intriguer whom Marie de Medici had created Maréchal d'Ancre, was killed in the court of the Louvre, the king, who was in his cabinet des armes, heard the noise of the pistols. Anne of Austria, his wife, one of the few women to detest roses and who could not even bear to see this magnificent queen of flowers painted in a picture, had a passion for fine bookbindings, and Monsieur Gaston d'Orléans sported medals and also rare books. As for Louis XIV, the best-staged king of his time, he was apparently ready to buy anything that would add magnificence to his court and be in keeping with his role of Roi Soleil. Notwithstanding his more or less decorative magnificence, however, this monarch was at times a hard bargainer, and like Isabelle d'Este, knew how to take advantage of needy or impecunious clients. His transactions with Jabach to buy from him the finest art collections in France are scandalous, nor can these transactions be solely attributed to Colbert, who was for a long time the go-between in this affair. Jabach was German by birth and Parisian by election, a rich banker, the director of the Compagnie des Indes Orientales, intelligent and a most passionate art collector. With great care and expense, he had formed the finest collection of his time. Later, through business reverses, his unbounded liberality to artists and the extravagant prices he paid for his masterpieces, Jabach finally found himself forced to part with his collection and entered into negotiations with Louis XIV, who knew its immense value. Dealings dragged on for a long time, and every day Jabach was more pressed by his creditors. Notwithstanding his necessitous condition, he rebelled at the absurd price offered and wrote to Colbert to beg the king to treat him as a Christian, not as a Moor. Finally, Louis XIV, the Roi Soleil, though in this affair a planet certainly that did not shine in generosity, gained his point and for the absurdly paltry sum of 200,000 livres became the owner of the renowned Jabach collection, composed of no fewer than 101 paintings, a great many of them masterpieces, and 5,542 drawings. It is sufficient to say that in this Jabach collection were works by Leonardo da Vinci, the Saint John, the Concert Champêtre by Giorgione, one of the few authentic works of this master, the Entombment of Christ, the Pilgrims of Emmaus, and the Mistress of Titian by Titian, all of which now belong to the Louvre Museum. With a king who played the connoisseur and collected objects of art and virtu, no gentleman of the French court would acknowledge indifference towards art, or be without a certain hobby of his own. Collecting some one thing in particular, being in fact what is generally defined as a specialist. Speaking of La Mode in his Les Caractères, La Bruyère lashes the collecting craze of his time without mercy. His chapter 13 treats of fads and fashion, and in it he tells of the ridiculous freaks of collectors and cleverly points out how utterly deprived of genuine meaning were the artistic pursuits of such amateurs. Nevertheless, with its good sides and its bad, the epidemic spread, not only in France, but in other countries as well. We will, however, confine our study of this epoch to France, as for the purposes of this brief resume of the collecting craze, France was ahead of the other countries, and thus by the side of the wise and genuine lover of art, possessed all the other degrees of collector mania. Though conforming to fashion, everyone has his own views of the matter, so that there are dreamers and speculators on all kinds of antiques, but painting is given the preference. Pictures are bullion, writes the fat Coulonge to his cold-blooded and well-behaved cousin, Madame de Sévigné. You can sell them at twice the price whenever you like. In fact, during one of his journeys to Italy, Coulanges, who had caught the collecting fever, made a considerable sum of money in buying and selling pictures, so much money that it spoiled his taste for, as a chroniclist said, the treasure, which he saw piled up at the Hotel de Guise awoke in him more expensive tastes. His wife, Marie-Angélique de Guibagnol, collected rare curios. Madame de Sévigné tells us of her delight when she saw in her cousin's house a looking glass that had been owned by Queen Marguerite. At this epoch, the art and curio market comprised all sorts of odd characters, and, as might be expected, the subject gave ample food to writers and chroniclers for skits. La Bruyère is not alone in making sport of the obsessed art collector and crazy curio hunter. From Molière to the Italian Goldoni, the antiquary and his victim are capital subjects. Poetry also contributes its sarcasm. In France, some of the minor and justly obscure poets are very useful in the reconstruction of our milieu. There are even chronicles written in verse. For instance, Marie-Thérèse, the wife of Louis XIV, goes to see Catherine Henriette Bellier de Beauvais, the first lady of the bedchamber of the Queen Dowager Anne of Austria, the lady who is evidently collecting art. The poetical chronicle at once informs the public that mercredi, notre auguste reine, chez Madame de Beauvais, pour le son aimable palais, voir les merveilles étonnantes et ratées surprenantes. We will spare the reader the description of the collection given in a sort of litany of praise, a sequence of lines like the following: tant de belles orfèvreries, tant d'éclatantes pierreries, tant de vases si précieux, tant de bustes et tant d'images, etc. Le Mésépris de Roche is crazy for books. And like a true bibliomaniac, he never reads his books, which are generally bought for the title, etc. This, of course, is more than enough for his introduction into one of these rhyming chronicles called Rimaille. Le livre de Roche en belle couverture, mais le maître n'ont science ni lecture. Paintings being given the preference, they are also the cherished subject for verse. Impassioned specialists who collected the works of a single artist and spend a lifetime in doing it are a capital subject. There is also an Arcadia among art collectors worthy of the 18th century, a regular Arcadia with pseudonames, etc. One of these rhymed chronicles records the various names assumed by the collectors and amateurs of the Arcadia. As we have said, many of the collectors of these paintings are specialists possessed of the hobby of collecting the works of a single master. Poussin is at one time the most fashionable, and while the Poussinists are among the most impassioned in proclaiming the merits of their artist, there are also other ists. Gamard, Sieur de Creze, Lieutenant de Chasse, is apparently at the head of the Poussinists. His Arcadian name is Pantolme. The widow of Lescaut, the jeweller who was one of Mazarin's advisers and was sent by the Cardinal to Spain in search of fine things, collects paintings, but happens to be a Rubenist. However, in due time she is converted by Pantolme, Gamard, to the Poussinist persuasion, and deserts the Flemish art of Rubens and starts a new collection as a Poussinist. She is called Irene in the Banquet du Curieux. It would take long to go over all the pleasantries of the curio hunters of this time. Bizot, named Lubin in the Banquet du Curieux, is a type of collector we have already introduced. Lubin, amateur de antiquailles, de livres anciens et de villes médailles, philosophe sans jugement, curieux sans raisonnement. Other odd characters have escaped record in rhyme. Sieur Bassin de Limville of Blois is a well-known collector of medals. He spent his whole life in buying nothing but medals. Yet no one ever saw his collection, as soon as they were bought, the medals were put away in his cabinet, declares an informant of the time. His cabinet is provided with an iron door and a lock with a key of the most complex make. At his death, the heir tried to open the door, but the key refused to open, there being some special handling besides the difficulty of the lock. The man who had made the key was dead, and the case was so hopeless that the heir was forced to enter Sieur de Limville's cabinet through an opening in the wall. Inside the cabinet there was found among a mass of cobwebs a dirty sack filled with the precious medals, the collection to which the deceased had given his whole life. La Bruyère tells of a man who spent all his years hunting for a bad etching of Callot. He knew the work was the poorest ever done by the artist, that it was not worth the trouble, but nevertheless gave his whole time and activity to the search for that etching because it was the only work of Callot that he did not possess. Jacob Spoon, a doctor of medicine and an intelligent but odd individual who died in the year 1685, declares that in his native city of Lyon, everyone is collecting something or other. Then, and perhaps as a physician he was in a position to know, he says that collecting is a disease, contagious though not fatal. There is no need of special documents to say that faking must have worked with a special ease in such a world. Brienne tells us that when Cardinal Mazarin received objects from Italy, Jabach and Magnard were charged to examine them, and very often more than one piece of faking was discovered. Very successful counterfeits. Mémoires de Brienne, chapter 9. There is no instance, to my knowledge, of any sentence passed by tribunal upon fakers at this time when everything seems to have been decided by the almighty power of Louis XIV or the ever-ready Parliament. Yet the police of Louis XIV seem to have one interest in the collecting of art. They must watch that the books, prints and paintings, etc., offered for sale contain nothing immoral or what we should call nowadays subversive. By this duty, the police of Louis XIV became specialists, going in chiefly for medals. In the year 1696, Pontchartrain wrote to Monsieur de la Reynie to send a man to watch the sale of Abbé Bizot and to be on the lookout for the Médaille Insolente of the said cabinet. After other injunctions, he then adds, "It is His Majesty's wish that the medals incurring suppression should be put into a sack, this to be sealed and taken to the mint." It is clear from this that over and above interest in bad coins and fake medals, the police of the Roi Soleil were on the lookout for a particular historical coin bearing some unfriendly allusion to the King of France, and their earnest efforts to suppress it had naturally made it so rare that it kindled the ambition of numismatists and collectors at large. The 18th century might be called the period of sales of art collections. Everywhere auctions were held of well-known collections. In Holland alone, we can register 185 catalogues of art sales from 1700 to 1750. This may be called a sort of record, however, as France in the same period of time counts only 30 catalogues. Following the art sales in Paris, we find that from 1751 to 1760, an average of 4 sale catalogues a year is reached. From 1761 to 1770, the average increases to 13. From 1771 to 1775 to 28. And from 1776 to 1785 to 42 each year. This is the climax. At this point, art sales were social functions and the auction room a place where society met. Collections were dispersed and new ones formed, and the transference of masterpieces from one collection to another through the auction room acquires unusual rapidity. Such a state of affairs inspires Thibaudoux with the following reflection, Thibaudoux, Préface du Trésor de la Curiosité. It is like a game of shuttlecock, in which the bourgeoisie and nobility throw masterpieces to each other, and with such swiftness that one really does not know to whom they belong. The 18th century, from the very beginning, numbers collectors such as Crozat, who had a palace in Rue Richelieu, and a collection of 19,000 drawings, 400 paintings, and 1,400 cameos, etc., Comtesse de Verrues and Baudelaire. The Duke of Orleans gallery contains 478 paintings, of which 3 were by Leonardo da Vinci, 15 by Raphael, 31 by Titian, 19 by Paul Veronese, 10 by Correggio, 12 by Poussin, and many others of the Dutch, Spanish, and other schools. This collection of the Duke of Orleans, one of the finest in France after that of Cardinal Mazarin, seems to have been pursued by the same ill luck as the latter. The regent's son, with deplorable prudery, destroyed all the paintings with nude figures. As for the rest of the collection, it was sold later to some English amateurs by Philippe Egalité. End of chapter 11. Chapter 12 of The Gentle Art of Faking by Riccardo Nobili. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Jordan Watts, Oxfordshire. Chapter 12. Some Notable French Collectors. Speculation, financial disasters. Many collections change hands. Fakers busy for newly enriched collectors. Voltaire plays the silent partner to art and curio dealers. Wonderful unearthings of Dr. Hubert. Collectors of the time, Madame Pompadour, Cardinal Soubise, Malesherbes and others. Interspace of the Revolution. Napoleon revives some of the speedy methods of the Romans. Italian museums and galleries plundered by his imperial agents. From this early period we enter that of the art sales, which, as we have already said, seem characteristic of the 18th century. Financial disasters and speculations disperse more than one fortune and usher newcomers into the world of finance. This is the time when masterpieces begin to change hands so rapidly. The spirit of collecting is superseded by that of commerce, and faking appears under new forms, those with no other trickery beyond what commerce with its intrigue and deceit can supply. All amateurs, writes a contemporary in the Chronique Scandaleuse, are now mixed up with brocantage, bric-a-brac. There is not a collector who does not sell or exchange, troc, either on account of unstable taste, or for the sake of gain, or to retaliate his own bad bargain upon someone greener than himself. Even Voltaire, between an epigram and a satire, found himself implicated in brocantage, only, more shrewd than Cicero, he saved appearances by an associate, the Abbé Moussinot, he remaining the sleeping partner. Voltaire's name and his banter over natural history and explanations of geological phenomena, Buffon, the author of a natural history that Voltaire called not all that natural, was one of his victims, he having replied to Buffon's learned hypothesis with regard to some seashells found on the summit of the Alps that the shells might have been lost by pilgrims on their way to Rome, recalls to our mind an 18th century successful piece of faking and practical joke played on an erudite collector, Dr. Louis Hubert of Würzburg. In the year 1727, two doctors of the town prepared a surprise for Hubert, a surprise by which his collection of fossils was to be enriched by some extraordinary specimens. Speculating on the enthusiasm and good faith of the learned doctor and impassioned collector, the two accomplices fabricated fossils of fantastic animals and the most impossible shells. The imitations were generally modelled in clay with the addition of a hardening substance. Incredible as it may sound, some of them represented ants and bees of the most heroic proportions, crabs of new line and shape, etc. These were carefully buried in ground of suitable character where Professor Hubert had been seen to excavate. The rest is easily divined. What is not easy to understand, however, is the fact that after having made several of these most incredible discoveries, Dr. Hubert thought it fit to publish a work consisting of 100 folios written in Latin and issued under the auspices of Professor Beranger. The book, which was dedicated to the Bishop of Franconia, had 22 illustrations reproducing with extreme exactitude Dr. Louis Hubert's fantastic antediluvian find. But this is not all. The learned faculty of science of Würzburg assembled to honour Dr. Hubert, and the doyen of the faculty pronounced a speech in praise of his discovery. What followed can be easily deduced. Only his good faith saved the deceived collector from the sore experiences of a modern sham discoverer of the North Pole. The curio world, however, still counts some good art lovers and serious collectors, such as Gerson, Basson, whom the Duc de Choiseul used to call le Maréchal du Saxe de la Curiosité on account of his daring and successful inroads on the art market, where, by the way, though no blood is shed, no less strategy is needed than on the battlefield. There are other names worth quoting in this century of decadence. Gloomy and his friend Rémy, painter and dealer in pictures and other curios, Julio, Langlier, Pelé, Renaud Delande, Pierre Lebrun and his son J.B. Lebrun, who married the famous artist Mademoiselle Vigy and owned the well-known Salle Lebrun, often used for celebrated sales. Other names might be quoted, La Marquise de Pompadour, Cardinal Soubise, Girardot de Berfond, Fontette, Malesherbes, Marquis de Palmy, etc. Then the revolution comes, the Ancien Régime disappears, and with it the dainty furniture, foppish dress, and the supremacy of an art market, which with all its oddities were such perhaps as had never been seen since the time of the orgy of curio hunting of ancient Rome. This supremacy, deprived of many of its idiosyncrasies, temporarily crossed the Channel and went to England accompanied by many of the treasures that dealers and refugees managed to save from the cataclysm of 1779. Napoleon may be quoted as an exceptional art collector, if ever such a name can belong to a man utterly deprived of a sense of art, but shrewd enough to understand the mighty support given to sovereigns by art. For in the process of time, the man formed more than one art collection by methods that in their drastic character greatly resemble those adopted by Roman generals and proconsuls. This statement is eloquently supported by facts and numbers. Here is a laconic writing of Napoleon, in which he informs the directory of his first artistic finds in Italy. Speaking of his agents, he states, "They have already seized 15 paintings from Parma, 20 from Modena, 25 from Milan, 40 from Bologna, 10 from Ferrara." This is, of course, his first experience as a novice collector. Other things were to follow. The Medici Venus from Florence, the Roman horses from Venice, and all the best works of art from the Italian museums, and these but foster more eclectic desires in this strange art lover, who, while preoccupied with the problem of transporting heavy statues from Rome and harvesting antiques and Renaissance work, indiscriminately orders to be taken to France with the artistic booty the votive pen that Justus Lipsius left to the sanctuary of Loreto and the votive image left by Montaigne to the same sanctuary. The anecdote of Lucius Mummius of ignorant memory is here repeated in a way, for the officials acting under Napoleon's orders have nothing to say about Montaigne's ex voto. But when it comes to the pen of Lipsius, these worthies gleefully remark, "La plume de Juste Lips qui avoir été estimée 5/8, s'est trouvée pesée 6/8. The pen of Juste Lips, which was supposed to weigh 5/8, has been found to weigh 6/8. From the Revolution to the time of Napoleon's dominion is the period in which the passion for art collecting is least felt. Faking, of course, is an art that does not pay and thus has no raison d'être. Yet faking passes from the field of art to that of real life. The new republic apes Roman customs. David the artist is faked into a tribune while busy painting Romans that seem to have been brought out of a hothouse, and he sketches semi-Roman costumes for the new officials of the Republic, garments that with all the foppishness of the old regime had Roman consular swords, imperial chlamys, mantle, faked buskins or ornamented cothurnus, boots worn by tragedians. It is this faking of life that feels the need even to alter the calendar, changing the Roman etymology of the names of the months into more resounding Latinesque appellations. At home in this staged drama of life, Napoleon, the friend of Talma and David, continues the grandiose faking with a sort of complex etiquette and a veneer of aristocracy, which makes one sadly think of the truth of the words pronounced by Couillet on General Bonaparte's elevation to the throne. He aspires to descend. Yet even in this peculiar and rather negative world, the chronicle of the Curia may contain some glorious names, and these no doubt prepared at the beginning of the 19th century the return of the cult of art in France, the reappearance of devoted collectors and enlightened amateurs. We may then name successively art lovers and intelligent collectors such as Lenoir, de Sommerville and Sauvageau, Revrol Villemain, and after them artists, collectors and dealers of the calibre of Mademoiselle Delaunay, Escudier, Montfort, Roussel, Berdelet, Henri Rongen, Mannheim, the first of a dynasty of honest and intelligent dealers. Then, almost in our own times, Baron de Villiers, Bonafé, Émile Peyre and others. But art collecting is now no longer an accentuated characteristic of France nor of England, Germany and other European countries which have a tradition and have come to the fore. But other new and powerful states have joined the contest, cast new types of collectors and created a new psychology in the art world, which will form the second part of this book. End of chapter 12 and part 1. Chapter 13 of The Gentle Art of Faking by Riccardo Nobili. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Jordan Watts, Oxfordshire. Part 2. The Collector and the Faker. Chapter 13. Collectors and Collections. Collectors and Collections. Various Kinds. Meaning of the word curieux. various types of collectors, the artist, the scholar, the eclectic and the specialist, a large class of collectors as defined by La Bruyère, the ultra-modern collector, the art and curio market, the three stages of the collector's career, the collector's touch, the elasticity of prices and an opinion of C.T. Yerkes, Gerson's advice and Schlegel's opinion, a Latin saying re-edited by Edmond Bonafé. La collection c'est l'homme, a well-known French lover of art and first-rate connoisseur used to say. Nowadays, this transformation of Buffon's threadbare saying is only partially true. It would perhaps be more correct to put it in the past tense, as a new type of virtuoso has arisen. A collector of the most recent brand prefers to buy collections ready-made. Such collections, all gathered in good order in the houses of these new collectors, speak very eloquently of the owner's financial power, but say nothing of his taste, ability, or love for the artistically fine and beautiful. However, this being somewhat of a recent change brought about by casual circumstances with hardly any claim as an artistic phenomenon, this study can be confined for the present to that normal period, barely past, when the art and curio collector was really a collector, and above all a lover of art as well as a passionate hunter after fine things. From the study of this semi-past world of art, it will be easy to proceed to a comparative analysis of the up-to-date one, to the new species of collector who in no way comes under the definition la collection c'est l'homme. In the foregoing review of collectors and collections, it has mostly been a question of art collectors, with only incidental reference to other kinds of art lovers. Curios, however, imply many other things. The French word curieux, which has often been used for lack of a better expression, has a wider meaning. The word curieux, which might be translated by the English word curious, without losing much of its meaning, may have originated in the Latin curiosis, though it is doubtful whether the Romans ever applied this word to connoisseurs of art or other collectors. The fact that the artistic world was then divided into lovers of the beautiful and faddists or fools, that erudites had not yet appeared, may have rendered new words of definitions useless. When speaking of his friend Statius as a connoisseur and virtuoso, Pliny uses the Greek word philoelos, friend of the beautiful, a word that might really be used to define the true and genuine collector. The French word curieux appears for the first time in a dictionary by Robert Estienne, 1531, and is defined un homme curieux d'avoir ou scavoir choses antiques. But later on, presumably from its probable Italian origin, the word acquires a wider sense, a sense that even finds an echo in Shakespeare, and so also the old meaning of gentilezza, as used by Lorenzo Medici, has a resonance, according to La Croix du Maine, in the French gentillesse ou gentille curiosité. Notwithstanding this limitation, for many the word curieux has the widest meaning and includes all kinds of collectors. Trevoux's definition res singulares eximinae rarae, with Millin's broadening comment tout ce qui peut piquer la curiosité par la singularité de forme ou de usage, all that may excite curiosity and strangeness of form or use is the proper one, regardless of Madame de Genlis, who as late as 1818 goes back to the old meaning and includes under curiosité the entirely scientific natural history collections. It must be said that the distinction between scientific and artistic pursuits is not always clearly defined. Science mingles with art with undisputed right, and scientific pursuits at times have artistic interest. The two seem either to alternate their rights or share them in the fields that lie between. In the artistic field, or rather in that which tallies with Millin's definition of la curiosité, there are two quite typical classes, even though they cannot be separated by a sharp line of delimitation on account of linking subdivisions. The one includes the art collector alone and the searcher for the beautiful, the other those gathering the rest, things which for strangeness of form or use present a certain interest to the collector. There is no doubt that those of the first class possess the impulsiveness that generally characterizes intuitive and non-learned experience in art, and those of the second combine artistic and scientific interests. The one has a tendency to consider and value objects in a different manner from the other. The artistic temperament has a penchant for synthesis. The scientific is inclined towards analytic methods. While the collector of the first class has a direct purpose, the search for what is artistically fine, the other is less absolute, and for him, objects have what may be called a relative value, the value of the series. In collecting coins or medals, the latter more especially, art plays an undisputed part, but science claims the right of classification, thus placing a relative value of no secondary importance. As a consequence, for instance, a medalist is likely to speak of the rare in place of the fine, or at times use one word for the other. It may be that in the eyes of a numismatist, a sample of inferior art acquires great value through its rarity and through the place that it may occupy in the series of his collection. There are some collections, consequently, in which the best artistic samples are forced to play a secondary part, the object of the collection being classification, such as shells, minerals, and other purely scientific gatherings would be arranged. This peculiar tyranny of science may even find scope for action in expressions of art, where science and erudition should have no claim. In museums of painting and sculpture, the history of art demands that the object should be classified according to epochs, schools, etc. The man intent upon such classification often becomes so engrossed in this one scientific side as to grow indifferent to those artistic considerations which give the painter and the real lover of art the joy art is intended to give. Even connoisseurship is often too tainted by erudition, and the curators of museums are very rarely aesthetes. At the sight of a fine work of art, a connoisseur is very often so intent on discovering the name of its author, the probable school and the epoch, all forms of classification, that he forgets he is before a work of art, that is to say, an expression of human sentiment, which whether good or bad was created solely to arouse artistic emotion in the beholder. The artist, while creating it, had certainly not in mind the history of art and all its erudite paraphernalia. There are two other distinctions in art collecting, distinctions so closely allied to the above classes that they share their respective characteristics in a very similar manner. They are represented by the eclectic collector and the specialist, two distinct orders, both useful in a way, both belonging to the artistic sphere. The eclectic is well defined by Gerson as an amateur whose passion presupposes taste and sentiment. The other, the specialist, generally regarded as having perfected his taste by dropping his initial eclecticism, is a collector who has restricted the field of his activity by grafting, so to speak, the purity of his artistic penchant on something that tends to diminish the broad outlook of an eclectic lover of art, and this in order to enlarge the possibilities of research and information. Thus, although the specialist has very often passed through an initial period of eclectic wandering, when he becomes a specialist he is very apt to forget his past enthusiasm for anything but his chosen speciality. Show a fine Limoges enamel to collectors of medals or a medal to a collector of enamels and you will realize the truth of the statement. Of course he will understand the beauty of the work, though not invariably, but he will take no interest in it. While having perfected his taste in some single branch of art, the specialist has unquestionably atrophied all artistic qualities in other directions. This theory naturally becomes more or less elastic according to the genre and the character of the art lover. A man who specializes on certain epochs is hardly a specialist in the true sense, but rather an eclectic who has restricted his pursuits so as to reconstruct in his mind the whole artistic expression of a certain age. The medalist and such like collectors have not such a wide scope, and their pursuits generally come to be characterized by method, order, and the whole Indian file of historic and erudite considerations. The tout ensemble of an eclectic's house presents a very decorative appearance. That of the specialist does not always, being mostly encumbered with glass cabinets or pieces of furniture with shelves adapted to his speciality. The eclectic collector will often speak of the beauty of a certain find from a purely artistic point of view. The specialist will grow poetic over the perfect cast, patina, etc. The specialist in medals will often show you two or three specimens of the same medal, only distinguished by the colour of the patina, or differences of no artistic value, and chronological considerations weigh with numismatists. The specialist must therefore frequently recur to scientific methods. In Paris there is a loose belief that an art lover who is an eclectic reveals a somewhat provincial sentiment, and that to be characterized as a true Parisian one must be a specialist in some one thing. This belief naturally implies that the specialist has refined his taste and acquired distinction from the grossness and obtuseness with which eclecticism is libelled. Yet this is hardly true. The best French collectors, such as de Villiers, Piot and others, were always enlightened eclectics in their various pursuits, though having a bent towards specialization. Nevertheless, we repeat that distinctions cannot be made with mathematical precision. The difference between artist and erudite, eclectic and specialist, would seem to have been well defined only by Bonafé in his characteristic saying, "The first throws himself upon his knees before beauty, the other asks her for her passports." Neither of the two methods ensure infallibility. The artistic collector, a lover at first sight, may be deceived by an imitation possessing character and general effect sufficient to pass in his eyes for the original. An erudite with his brain in the place of his heart, who demands passports before making up his mind, may be duped by a forged passport, by an imitation, that is to say, in which the details are respected even to the sacrifice of the totality which so greatly appeals to artists. There is one more kind of art and curio collector, perhaps the most numerous of all. They have been well defined by La Bruyère more than 200 years ago. This particular type of art lover is on the lookout not for what he really loves, but for that which affords him gratifications other than those art is intended to give. It is not an amusement, says the author of La Caractère in his chapter on fashion, but a passion often so violent that it lags behind love and ambition only as regards the paltriness of its object. Passing then from the description of the effect to the cause, La Bruyère proceeds, "La curiosité is a taste for what one possesses and what others do not possess, an attachment to whatever is the vogue or the fashion. It is not a passion felt generally for rare and fashionable things, but only for some special thing that is rare and above all in fashion." To this last category, with a few slight modifications, belongs the type of collector who might be called ultra-modern to distinguish him from his modern confrère of yesterday. A type that can lay no claim whatever to the definition la collection c'est l'homme, because he never troubles himself to hunt for works of art or curios, never experiences the joys of discovery, experiences nothing perhaps but being cheated by dealers, friends and experts. The ultra-modern collector is, of course, amply supplied with money and relies chiefly on his checkbook. He is always far from the spot where he might learn wisdom, yet not so far as to be beyond the pale of the deceit and trickery of the market of la curiosité. This latest variation carries one direct to the modern American type of collector, not because the type does not exist in other countries, but because America has furnished the champion specimens who, through the magnitude of their speculations in art and curio hunting, have stamped the type. Yet even in America, where art lovers like the late Quincy Shaw, Stanford White, H. Walters, etc. have been known, the ultra-modern type represents a very recent and astonishing novelty. One conversation on art with this modern collector is generally sufficient to reveal all absence of real passion. These greedy buyers of works of art and curios have often hardly the time to give even a glance at their glamorous purchases. They have certainly not the enjoyment that other collectors have. When they show their collections, a common way of soliciting admiration is to recount the unreasonable and extravagant prices paid. What are they after? What is their main object in ransacking old Europe for artistic masterpieces to be carried off by the sheer force of money? Levesque says one is a connoisseur by study, an art lover by taste, and a curieux by vanity, to which Imbert wisely adds, or speculation. Making every possible exception, vanity and speculation still appear to rule alternately the ultra-modern collector. We do not deny that many of them may be animated by the noble desire to leave their collections to their countries, but yet on closer study the attraction for the greater number of them seems to be either a modification of their financial interests, namely sport and speculation combined, or an inclination to spend money lavishly, everything being too easily possible by reason of their great money power. In a humorous toast at an American dinner, Stanley, the explorer, said that a citizen of the United States is never at rest till he has found something that he actually cannot afford to buy. The definition fits the millionaire art collector with more correctness and exactitude. In this field he shows himself a regular blasé of buying possibilities, and his passion for art and curios may to some extent bring him out of his torpidity by the extra magnitude of the investment. As Bernard Shaw says, a millionaire can buy 50 motor cars, but can only drive one at a time. He can buy food for a whole city, but he has only one stomach to digest it, secure all the seats in the theatre, but can only occupy one. But to own a work by Michelangelo or Raphael is a different tale. It affords one the sensation of owning and driving 100 or more motor cars at the same time in a sort of modern, ultra-modern, triumphal march of glory to the up-to-date Olympus of the privileged, where fame is highly seasoned with self-advertisement and superlatives the daily ingredient of reputation. For others, the modern whim of collecting works of art may represent a diversion from business, or a way in which to astonish the natives. From this type we come to the old forms of foolishness, the Trimalchos, Euctuses and Pauluses, etc., who have changed the ancient palanquin carried by slaves for a brightly coloured motor of 60 or 90 horsepower. One reason why this modern type of collector is so commonly deceived is because he generally lives in a sort of fool's paradise of art trumpery, separated from the real art market by a little understood feeling of aristocratic pride. The art collectors of olden times used to mingle with dealers, learn from them where and what to buy, tramping from place to place, the former El Dorado of the find. The modern species would consider it beneath him to have anything to do with common dealers or to attend a public sale, even for the sake of interest in art. How can they gain experience? They may engage an expert. No doubt a good expert can assist them, but the real collector carries his experience in his pocket, for the expert, like the gendarme of the well-known French operetta, arrives always too late. Sometimes a legion of experts are not able to save one from deception. A well-known American collector, on a visit to Italy with his small court of experts, was once offered in Florence a crystal cup supposed to have been cut by Valerio Vicentino. With the full approval of the experts, the cup was bought for the not inconsiderable sum of $4,000. The handsome find turned out to be the work of a faker practicing in the north of Italy, and the whole scheme planned by a non-Florentine dealer. The fancy prices paid for antiques today and the peculiar idiosyncrasies of this new species of collector have quite logically somewhat changed the character of the commerce, have given another tonality to the milieu in which the art lover moves. It must be admitted that the trade in antiques and curios is now far less interesting than formerly. The antiquary and dealer of yore were most interesting and characteristic. Their business could be defined by the Horatian adage, "Omni tulis punctum qui miscuit utili dolci." He wins the praise of all who mingles the useful with the pleasant. For while they had a keen eye to business, they also possessed the passion and intelligent understanding of art. The real antiquary hardly exists today. At best, he is represented by some old champion, the solitary survivor of a past generation. The modern variety, even the most enlightened, is nothing but an ordinary dealer. It is no exaggeration to say that traders and antiquaries like old Mannheim and the rest, whose intelligent criticism and learning was of such assistance to the collector, are no more. The vulgar jobbery of the dealer of today may eventually find its justification in the commonplace, unintelligent and gross clientele upon which it practices. With few exceptions, the ability of this pseudo-antiquary of today is more the ability of a common jobber than of an intelligent man. The trade has lost to a great extent the old artistic savour. Bluff has succeeded capability. The new strategy is based upon knowing before others when some new Croesus has become a votary of art. Upon getting in touch with him before he has lost his money or his illusions, it relies also upon what the French call puffing what he has to sell, and a keen insight into the client's weak side, the ability to fan his pride and ambition. Of course, as stated above, there are happy exceptions, merchants still honouring the trade who deal with absolute rectitude, and would be ashamed to resort to the aforesaid indirect methods to conclude a sale. But nevertheless, the gods are departing, and the erstwhile dealer plus antiquary, this interesting figure once afforded by the art and curio market, has vanished. To whatever order the collector may belong, exception being made for the ultra-modern type who, generally speaking, has in our opinion hardly any claim to the title of art collector, or even simple curio hunter, there generally exists a preparatory stage in his career. No matter how the mania or passion has been caught, there are three stages in its course that can very rarely be suppressed. The genesis of the passion is seldom spontaneous. There is generally an infective cause that helps the development of the fever for antiques and curios. "I believe," says Major H. Byng Hall in his book The Adventures of a Bric-a-brac Hunter, "my friend Mrs. Haggleton's taste for collecting the plate of Queen Anne's era originated in the fact of her aunt having left her a teapot of that admirable period of the goldsmith's art in England. The teapot inspired an ardent desire to possess other articles of the same style. The lady mildly commenced with salt spoons and became in due course the proud owner of mustard pots, salt cellars and one large piece of sideboard plate, which from the day she purchased it to that of her death every night faithfully accompanied her to her bedroom. My old bachelor friend Croker, again, began collecting Wedgwood because someone had told him he possessed a very fine specimen, while to my certain knowledge he was as ignorant of its value and exquisite design as his own footman would have been. There are naturally worthier causes, far higher and more pleasing motives to lead a man of refined taste to become a real practical collector, or dreamer according to circumstances, but the genesis above quoted, to which might be added the having of a collector among friends or relations, is the most common. One thing is certain, when the passion is genuine and consequently gives proof of being of a character that promises success and satisfaction, there is no cure for it. It becomes chronic almost invariably. The first stage upon which the collector or simple bric-a-brac hunter is likely to enter might be called the rosy period of his career. He is generally inclined to optimism. He dreams of nothing but masterpieces and astonishing finds, to such an extent that he sees chefs-d'oeuvre everywhere. If he owns capital, this is of course his most perilous period. If he has no capital, everything depends upon his wisdom, his credit, or the possibility of borrowing money. Naturally, we are only referring to the most acute cases. Temperaments vary, and the infection may be more or less dangerous according to the disposition of the individual. Curiously enough, in this collectomania fever, the first time what might be called a chill is taken, improvement sets in, convalescence perhaps. Chills in the purchasing of curios and antiques often mean an awakening of suspicion of being cheated. A very bad chill, ague in fact, is usually experienced with the first bad bargain, when, ignorant of possible dangers, one considers oneself a full-fledged connoisseur and adds to one's private collection a pseudo-masterpiece, realizing too late that the purse has been considerably lightened by a round sum paid for rubbish. There is hardly a more sudden and effectual method of learning wisdom. Some learn at once, others are obdurate and need a whole sequence of misadventures before realizing that they have been cheated, or becoming aware that they themselves are chiefly responsible for being cheated. These latter over-cheated ones, more especially, either abandon the amusement in a moment of despondency, or, if they persist, enter upon the second stage of preparatory training, a stage most characterized by skepticism and distrust. At this moment you might offer the neophyte a genuine Titian for a mere song, and, blinded by fear, he is likely to believe it a copy. Offer him the most authentic medal by Pisanello, the very one he desired, and he will hesitate. Hesitation and colour blindness are metaphorically the main characteristics at this time. There is, however, a good-natured type who oscillates, pendulum-like, between one stage and another, from enthusiasm to depression. Emerging from this second stage of semi-despondency, the neophyte is in all probability regaining a certain equilibrium and realizes above all that the buying of antiquities and curios is no easy matter to be handled by the first newcomer, even though well stocked with money. This is a salient point in real progress, and from this time each year will add experience and connoisseurship. If the art lover possesses the so-called collector's touch, it is at this particular stage he will discover that such a gift without study and practice does not lead to infallibility. Speaking of this quality which every beginner believes himself to possess, it cannot be denied that there are people who do have a certain happy intuition of things, an almost miraculous sixth sense, fully testifying to the existence of what the English call the collector's touch and the French name le flair, but alas, it is so very rare. Think of it, rhabdomancy in art. An amateur's education is in most cases slow and by no means an easy conquest. There are no books that can teach him the practical side, the safe and important side. Book learning is certainly of great assistance as secondary matter and completely subordinated to the education of the eye. Some of the best art connoisseurs, those of the surest touch, come from an ignorant class of workers, such as the celebrated Coureur of Paris or the Milanese Basilini, a former carter who was often consulted by Morelli, the Italian art critic and inventor of the analytical method, a connoisseur of undisputed merit. An antiquary of repute and art dealer of the old school claims that the perfecting of the eye resembles the focusing of a photographic apparatus, with the difference that in photography one can learn how to focus with almost mathematical precision, whereas in connoisseurship it is a continual focusing, for when what looks like a supreme conquest is reached, the eye becomes still more perfect and exacting. Similar progress characterizes the proper valuation of prices, the most elastic side of the trade. It must be remembered that as soon as an object leaves the shop to enter the collection of a collector of repute, it increases in value, because it is presumed to be genuine and choice, having been selected by an art lover of cultivated taste. Then, too, away from the chaos of the shop and in a good light, a work of art shows at its best. In every branch of commerce there are shops and shops. Piccadilly and Cheapside mean the same also in the world of curio and bric-a-brac. In conclusion, apart from the pleasure afforded by the pursuit of fine objects, there is hardly a better way for a collector to invest his money, provided he knows how to do it, and there is no worse business, none so unreliable and hastily ruinous as curio hunting, if one is not a true and real hunter. What to buy a safe investment is told by Gesson, a dealer and connoisseur of the 18th century. He says that, by sticking to what is beautiful and fine, one has the satisfaction of becoming the possessor of things that are always valuable and pleasing. I dare say that going in for the beautiful diminishes the probabilities of being duped, as often happens to those who are content with the mediocre or are tempted by low prices. It is very rare that a first-rate work of art does not realize at least the price paid for it. The mediocre is likely to lead to a loss. This advice, however, tacitly presupposes the collector to be able to tell the fine from the mediocre, to be, in a word, either an artist or a connoisseur. With this part of connoisseurship, we propose to deal in another chapter at the end of this work. At present, we would state that the safest thing for an art and curio collector to do, whatever his ambition, is to become acquainted with the various ways of the peculiar milieu into which he is about to enter, to train his eye as much as possible, to be diffident at first, and to have a passionate love for his interesting pursuit. It will then be for the collector a source of no common enjoyment and a most pleasing occupation, an occupation somewhat justified by the following lyricism of Schlegel. There is no more potent antidote to low sensuality than the adoration of the beautiful. All the higher arts of design are essentially chaste without respect to the object. They purify the thoughts as tragedy purifies the passions. Their accidental effects are not worth consideration. There are souls to whom even a vestal body is not holy. As the reverse to the ideal side, let us warn the neophyte that the supreme joy of art hunting is often embittered by the jealousy of colleagues, and that benevolence in the environment in which the collector moves is as rare as the ceramics of Henry II and the painting of Michelangelo, so much so that Edmund Bonafé was fully justified in re-editing an old Latin saying into Homo homini lupus, faemina faeminae lupior, curiosus curioso lupissimus. A man against man is like a wolf, woman against woman still more so, but most of all is curio hunter against curio hunter. End of chapter 13. Chapter 14 of The Gentle Art of Faking by Riccardo Nobili. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Jordan Watts, Oxfordshire. Chapter 14. The Collector's Friends and Enemies. Curio Trading. The Collector's Friends, Semi-Friends and Enemies. The Antiquary, the so-called Private Dealer, the Dealer, Bric-a-Brac Vendor and Others of the Species. Art Critics and Experts. Courtiers and Other Go-Betweens. Madame Roland writes in her famous memoirs that one of her greatest objections to a certain suitor was the fact that he was a trader. "In commerce," said this brilliant victim of the French Revolution, "one is supposed to buy at a low figure and sell at an exaggerated price, a scheme usually demanding the aid of lies." Leaving with Madame Roland the responsibility of such an assertion, it is quite safe to say that the trade in antiques, the flourishing commerce in curios, is a trade, if ever there was one, in which objects are bought cheap and sold at a high price, with a stock of lies as a necessary asset. Naturally, the statement does not imply that every dealer is a confirmed liar, ready to take advantage of the incautious and unskilled novice through misrepresentation. Yet even at its best, the character of the trade in our day is such that it is difficult to score success without, what shall we say, flavouring opportunity with fantastic tales, without firing the client's enthusiasm with some form of mirage, namely, tricking his good faith to entice him within the orbit of faith. Point out to a buyer, for instance, the different parts of an object that have been skilfully restored, and 9 times out of 10 the customer will drop the whole business. It is incredible the amount of stuff even a good art lover will swallow if properly offered by a person he trusts, just as it is incredible to see how the enhancing of merits with grey lies will help the conclusion of a good round piece of business. One must have had a glimpse at the makeup, have taken a peep behind the scenes to become aware that the more imposing the transaction, the more diverting and genial is the comedy played before the customer, who, at first a spectator, in due time will be called in most cases to take his part in the play, the part of the duped. There are methods to work up public enthusiasm greatly resembling those adopted by the scheming capitalist in the stock exchange. An English curio dealer of unquestionably high repute realized large profits on Dresden china by the artful way he put before the public an article apparently out of fashion with collectors of ceramics. For 2 or 3 years he bought all the Meissenware within reach until he had accumulated a large quantity at extremely low figures. He then began sending pieces to noted auction sales, where he invariably sent agents to buy them in after running the objects up to an extravagant price. This trick gradually built up a reputation for Meissen china. Some noted collector began to take an interest in it, others followed in his wake. When Meissenware became the rage and prices were accordingly high, the shrewd dealer got rid of his stock at an astonishing profit. Nothing absolutely dishonest, one may observe. Yet without stopping to ask whether the auction comes within Madame Roland's hyperbolic conception of honesty, it cannot be denied that in the fine art and curio trade, what might be defined as the staging part is the most important, even if it finds its greatest justification in clients who follow one another in taste like so many sheep. The trade in curios may be more specifically outlined by the study of the dramatis personae taking part in it. It will then be seen that the artifice practiced by the London antiquary of good repute is rather an anodyne form of misrepresentation. Such trade tricks differ from the commonplace ones characterizing unclean dealing in other branches of commerce. There is a smack of genius about them which might at times plead for the pardon that draconian laws accorded to well thought out and talented forms of theft. A picture of the clever plots and amusing intrigues planned to the detriment of the modern collector would demand the pen of a Molière. Only the illustrator of Monsieur Tartuffe could give the proper colouring to such inconceivable plays. These plays are hardly new, however. They have been constantly acted and reacted with credible success and enlivening innovations. Formerly fools alone were the victims, rarely real collectors. Today it is different. With the advent of the new type, old distinctions have disappeared. Some among the many art collectors are intelligent in their work and far from being beginners. They are outsiders, however. Let them look within the penetralia, into the mysteries, the hidden secrets of the trade so carefully concealed from them, and they will learn how little exaggeration there is in the saying that a large portion of the business in antiques and curios is tainted with fraud, charlatanism, etc., and that even some of the best collectors of our time have been deceived to such an extent that they live surrounded by their objects of virtu as in a sham El Dorado. One of the late Rothschilds, a man known traditionally and de facto as a connoisseur, a type of genuine collector, used to say that all the objects of his collection were, like Caesar's wife, above suspicion. Yet by the side of the finest masterpieces there were some in that collection which were, metaphorically speaking, wives that Caesar would certainly have repudiated. I would no more admit forgeries to my collection than I would allow my wife to wear paste diamonds, was the boast of a well-known collector of bronzes in Paris to a party of connoisseurs lunching with him. But excuse me, retorted a moralizing friend who was dying to reveal the truth to the great specialist, no one is safe nowadays. There, pointing to a bronze figure, that is, what shall I say, a paste diamond. That object is a fake. I can tell you where it was cast. It was offered me very likely by the same fellow that must have palmed it off on you. There was no trial, however, because the great bronze specialist recovered his money from the dealer, but, alas, not his unblemished reputation. Such stories are not strange when it is considered that museums are regularly infested by forgeries and spurious objects, and that these have been admitted to public collections with the full approbation of learned curators and clever specialists. It is easy to estimate how rampant and keen faking must be now that incredible prices are paid for articles of virtu. How the antiquary, the dealer, the go-between and other characters in this world of deception may prove to be, according to circumstances, the friend or the enemy of the curio collectors is readily understood. Discrimination, sometimes too late, will teach who is a helper and who not. The antiquary is generally a dealer who has no shop, but keeps objects of art in his tastefully furnished house, allowing his private show to be visited only by whom he chooses. He is, as it were, the aristocrat of the trade, the one who is presumed to ask and get the highest prices. This select dealer's success is according to his ability, integrity, or the reputation for trustworthiness he enjoys among collectors. We would repeat that the private dealer belongs to this high branch of the trade without any definite division. Very often he is a disguised trader with the grand air of a gentleman, an air that has to be paid for by the client, who is less likely in such a sphere to attempt to drive the hard bargain that is peculiar to the humble bric-a-brac shops. The best and most reliable antiquaries and private dealers must logically be reckoned among the friends of the art lover. The latter is likely to pay them astonishing prices, but he also pays for security. He knows that the dealer's experience is absolutely at his service, and that if by mischance an object is not what it has been represented to be, the honest dealer will make it good. To end with a brief classification, it may be noted that there are dealers whose shops have private rooms in the rear where trade can be carried on in the same way as with a dealer who has no shop. From this double-faced form we pass to the real shopkeeper, the vaster class ranging from the vendor who can afford to fill his window with the choicest samples down to the modest curio shop, the benevolent harbour of the humbler modes of expressing art. With the exception of the unassuming curio shop, which is still unchanged though less replete with interesting things and quite denuded of tempting finds, the disappearance in the dealer of his former artistic sentiment has fermented in the trade the spirit of association. Trusts and alliances have been formed by big firms, though the advantage to the amateur is to be doubted. At one time such a thing was very uncommon, if not impossible, being apparently prevented by the dealer's originality and artistic temperament. Monsieur, je ne suis pas le gendarme de la curiosité, old Mannheim used to say to the novice showing him objects not purchased from his gallery. This was the old attitude of the trade. We do not mean that all behaved like Mannheim in refusing to play the part of the policeman of curio dealing. Others may have taken the opportunity to run down an article sold by a neighbour, but there was no probability of an object passing from one firm to another in search of better success, or going from Paris to London and vice versa to find the proper atmosphere or the suitable kind of knavery. Psychologically speaking, this is speculating on a faddism similar to that which induces the Parisian dandy to send his shirts to London to be ironed. and at the same time suggests an inverted game to the London snob, who may believe that Parisian starch is without an equal for shirt fronts. The spirit of association and a perfected knowledge of the idiosyncrasies of the modern buyer have led to the discovery that some objects show to better advantage in Paris and that others gain in the sombre grey atmosphere of London, that each background has its peculiar value and may be turned to account respectively in the realization of higher figures. There are even special cases when to fetch the best price an object must be sent to its birthplace where the freakish or immature client's fancy may be tickled to advantage. The whole of this complex game in modern curio dealing may be summed up in the single maxim, find the vulnerable spot, the Achilles heel of your client and you are safe. It must be added that the Achilles heel of the modern collector may be of a more complex anatomy, but is of more extended proportions than that of the Greek hero. As soon as a star of first magnitude bursts forth upon the financial sky to rise upon the artistic one, all the forces of the latter quickly learn dynamic precision, the extent of possibilities. Whether erratic or not, the orbit of the new star will be studied throughout its course with astronomical exactitude. To continue the metaphorical image, it may be added that should the new star prove to be of solar magnitude, a whole planetary system of cupidity and greedy desire will soon be formed within its golden rays. From now forward, it is of this shady brilliancy of the planetary system of the curio world that we intend to speak. The honest dealer needs neither our praise nor defence. He can take care of himself, and the esteem he enjoys plainly divides him from the sphere upon which we are entering, the precinct of an art and curio inferno which might bear Dante's superscription, "Through me is the way to the city dolent." As the main principle of curio dealing is to buy at a low figure and sell at the highest price possible, it is evident that when this apothegm falls into the hands of the unscrupulous, the art of buying and selling takes on most Machiavellian hues. The infrequency of good bargains, which are becoming rarer every day, has lately fostered the activity of competition, making the art of buying a shrewd, unscrupulous game, in which the dealer, with his numerous emissaries, is prepared, Proteus-like, to invest himself with every imaginable part. If an object cannot be secured in a direct manner, the dealer will indulge in side play, called in the Italian argot of the trade, di mattonella. When dealers are not admitted, and it is important that the object should be inspected before the conclusion of a business transaction, the antiquary or shopkeeper, namely the buyer, is generally careful to hide his professional quality. He is often introduced as a foreign casual visitor interested in art. If the pretended foreigner does not succeed in obtaining the object because the owner, perhaps a gentleman, has demanded a big price, then other characters, the decoys in the play, may be put upon the stage to say that the object is not worth the price, that it has been injured in restoration, etc. Sometimes the pseudo-foreigner assumes the part of a novice, naively confessing that he is not versed in antiques, but should Professor so-and-so give a favourable opinion, he would willingly remit the price. The rest is left to the sham professor. Of the self-disguising tendency of a noted Italian antiquary when in search for the ever-rarer good bargains, the following amusing story is told. A noble family of Pisa were induced, by financial circumstances, to part with some of their valuable works of art and made the condition that no antiquary or dealer was to be mixed up in the transaction. A certain Florentine antiquary, noted for craft and trickery, in particular, was to be excluded. The said antiquary got wind of the unusual opportunity and managed to visit the palace in the guise of a stranger. He saw a certain work of art and a bargain was struck with Count Z, the head of the family, to the satisfaction of them both. As the antiquary was about to leave, the nobleman said, confidentially, "Don't let anyone know about this affair, nor that I am selling things. I have a particular objection to dealers, above all, to a certain intriguer and thief." Here he named the very man he was addressing. When bargains are made on the plan of exchanging one object for another, they are no less disastrous for the unwary and ignorant owner. There are Madonnas by good Renaissance artists that countrymen and villagers have gladly bartered for cheap modern chromo-like paintings worth only a few francs, old artistic stuccos and bas-reliefs secured for some cheap piece of plaster cast, pieces of old damask exchanged by ignorant priests for a few yards of brand new shining satinette. Even such exchanges necessitate at times certain wiles, such as stories by go-betweens, garbed as monks or priests, posing as benevolent friends of the church or some other meek character. A philodramatic society, owning a small theatre, once used a piece of fine Flemish tapestry as a drop curtain. Dark and unattractive to the untrained eye, the curtain was hung for lack of a better. It was objectionably heavy to raise or lower. To make things easier and lighter, a Maecenas of the dramatic art offered to exchange the old clumsy curtain for a new one painted in the most approved style. The proposal was accepted with enthusiasm, and after some time it was casually found out by one of the actors that their former curtain had been sold in Paris to a French collector for a sum that would have built the needy society a palatial theatre. If a dealer does not succeed in securing a work of art, he is apt to spoil all chances for others by what is known as mettere il bavaglino, that is, metaphorically, to tie a bib around the neck of the object. The game is played by enthusiastically praising the article that it has not been possible to acquire. When a certain kind of dealer finds that his offer has not been accepted, he becomes artful, admitting that he has tendered all he is able to give, but that he honestly recognizes the article to be worth more. Proceedings now evolve much as follows. How much do you think it is really worth? Asks the owner with legitimate curiosity. A dealer richer than myself might pay so-and-so, but then an outsider, of course. Here the trickster is not likely to estimate the work, but will vaguely convey an idea of its immense value by telling of recent sales where millions have been paid for works of art. The result is that the owner loses all balance as regards the value of his object, and in all probability will never sell it for the simple reason that he raises the price every time the sum demanded is reached. A doctor in Lucca who possessed a passable Maestro Giorgio, a ceramic piece that may have been worth 10,000 francs, was unacquainted with its value and would have been willing to sell it for 5 francs. He received an offer of 50 francs for it, and thinking it generous for a cracked bit of earthenware, became suspicious. Very soon the dealer bid 1,000 francs, then gradually worked up to 3,000, the price he had made up his mind not to pass. Then, when the bib was properly bound round the article, he boldly offered 50,000, naturally intending to turn it all into a joke should the offer be accepted in good faith. The castle builder died dreaming of millions, of course before having parted with his dish. The heir sold it for a moderate sum, so moderate a one that it might have raised a posthumous protest from the dead doctor. In like manner, but this time by way of a joke, an antiquary persuaded a countryman that a brass dish he owned, for which he had refused the few francs that it was worth, was priceless, that there was gold in the alloy, and that the chiselling was a lost process in the art of working brass. The specimen was rarissimo, he said. As a finishing touch and to give it a flavour of Boccaccio-like humour, he occasionally sent friends to play the part of anxious buyers, offering higher and higher sums. Gradually dealers entered into the spirit of the joke, and on passing the village never failed to offer a few hundred francs more for the now celebrated dish. This trick is also called inchiodare un oggetto, to nail down an object, and is variously denominated in the different provinces of Italy, the curio dealer's argo varying according to district. The slang peculiar to the trade has not a wide vocabulary, but comprises a few phrases and words by which the initiated can express an opinion upon some special thing or the artistic value of a certain object without being understood by the outsider. For instance, the word musica is indicative of faked objects, not as a single word but set in a colloquial phrase. A dealer who wants his aide-de-camp or go-between to know that the object in question is modern and not worth wasting time over, yet would convey this opinion in the presence of the proprietor without letting him understand, is likely to warn his colleague in some way such as this: "Before I forget it, remind me to buy that piece of music," or any other phrase in which music comes in naturally. To state that a price is too high, that there is no margin for business, or maybe even risk, the dealer will use the word bagnarsi, to get wet. It may also be merely hinted as, for instance, "Have you your umbrella, if it should be raining?" or, in good weather, "No need for umbrellas." Rather than containing a wealth of words, the jargon is fanciful and pliable, forming a sort of summary Esperanto, which with a few words furnishes the freemasonry of the trade with multiform expressions. The complementary characters to which we have alluded in our bird's eye view of the curio market are liable to exchange their functions according to the moral principles directing their actions, and in this peculiar chameleon-like attitude change colour and hide from friendship to enmity, assisting the collector in his pursuit, namely, of helping the dealer to dupe him. In broad terms, they include art critics, experts, go-betweens, and many metamorphoses of the most variegated agents. To these forces must be added the silent help that is generally operative in favour of the dealer. These are drawn from the multiform and numerous guilds of the restorer and from the questionable side of the trade, namely, fakers, assumed owners, noblemen or pseudo-noblemen, willing to lend paternity and pedigree to works of art, smugglers, and other degenerate forms of criminal and semi-criminal activity. Speaking of the friends and enemies of the collector whose cooperation is more or less openly apparent and of a less mysterious character, it may be said that the art critic and expert once represented two entirely distinct forms of interest in art. A certain recent evolution of the art critic tends to intermingle the two groups. The art critic of years ago was, as a rule, either a literary man who had a notion that he knew all about art by simple instinct, or a scholar who, having studied the historical part of art, imagined that this knowledge was more than sufficient to label him a connoisseur. The victims of this misunderstanding were not only the art critics themselves, but museums and public institutions trusting to their knowledge of art and giving them posts as curators or advisors, thus throwing their gates wide open to faking, as erudition without eye or experience seems to possess that deceitful form of suggestion which so rarely affects the cold, keen intuition of the real connoisseur. That scientists fall an easy prey to suggestion and are prone to daring or misleading hypotheses in art or archaeology is beyond question. It is perhaps in the nature of their analytical work to tend to remain purely and simply analytical. Numerous and interesting anecdotes could be repeated. A case of archaeological suggestive fancy is told by Paul Udall. A piece of pottery was brought to a member of the Académie des Inscriptions as it bore a rather cryptic sequence of letters that had proved puzzling to other authorities. The pot with the letters in question, MJDD, had been excavated near Dijon. As soon as the Académicien saw the letters, he had no hesitation in pronouncing it to be a Roman vase, a small amphora used as an ex voto. The letters, he said, represented the initials of the Latin invocation, Magno Jove Deorum Deo. Being a question of a votive offering, nothing would be more consistent than the words, "To the great Jupiter, the God of Gods." Unfortunately, such a splendid piece of inductive learning was shattered when an ordinary art dealer examined the jar and declared it to be anything but ancient, a mustard pot, in fact, the initials meaning Moutarde Jaune de Dijon. For a considerable time, an inscription found on a worm-eaten piece of signboard puzzled the world of erudites. The inscription, evidently the work of a jester, ran thus: I-C-I-E-S-T-L-E-C-H-E-M-I-N-D-E-S-A-N-E-S. Needless to say, many explanations of the obliterated letters were prompted by the learned suggestive fancy of professors and many interesting reconstructions of the ancient inscription were given. The riddle, however, was not solved till someone perfectly unacquainted with the art of reading old inscriptions happened to read the letter straight off without regard to spacing, furnishing the following true explanation. Ici est le chemin des anges. This is the way for asses has since become a byword in lampooning blind erudition. Though art was not in question here, the anecdote nevertheless illustrates a tendency of inductive science, a mania, namely, for hypothesis and explanations, which in the case of art often encourages the blunders of autosuggestion. A great distinction between practical and learned opinion is that the former rarely gives at first sight the name of the author of a painting or statuary, whereas the latter almost invariably baptizes works of art. Hardly has a learned art critic cast his eye upon a work and out pops the name of the artist, the school, etc. Let him talk and you will soon discover that his conclusions are not based chiefly on the perfected comparative work of his eye, but upon notions that book reading has massed in his head. He will refer to the now almost prohibited and threadbare authority of Vasari. What would an art critic do without Vasari either to abuse or quote, saying that such and such an artist painted so and so, and speak of the influences of masters and schools, go through a list of quotations from Crow and Cavalcaselle down to more modern writers, display any amount of borrowed wisdom but no originality. Finally, through lack of a trained eye, he will grow poetic and enthusiastic impartially before a genuine work or a faked masterpiece. Were not curio dealers a rather close-mouthed guild, they might divulge some interesting incidents with regards to this subject and prove that though the case is uncommon, there are in this trade not only fakers of great masters, but master fakers of public opinion as well. Of the expert, Henry Rochefort says, "At first this name expert appears to awaken us the majestic idea of science and authority, a dangerous opinion to entertain." As a matter of fact, there is no control, for, as Rochefort goes on to remark, who can prevent a citizen from calling himself, for instance, an expert in pictures? The dangerous vagueness of the profession, the facility with which the title is acquired, together with the multitudinous offices it fills, makes of the expert a perilous companion at times. There is no doubt that when the magniloquence of the title is justified, through unquestionable ability, supported by a reputation of untainted honesty, the expert may be of the greatest and most valuable assistance a collector can desire. His ability must then be paid for at what it is worth. But even when highly paid, it is cheap compared with the blunders the expert is likely to save the collector, those costly blunders that are so often an integral part of the commencement of the career. On the other hand, what an ignorant expert, in his supreme disdain for learning, is capable of saying when tendering information is incredible. Rochefort has made an amusing collection of blunders by experts when called upon to pronounce an opinion on matters in which practice counts for nothing. The anecdotes were gathered by the French writer in the public auction rooms of Paris, where the expert has an official function. Here he is prepared to furnish details and useful hints regarding the objects put up for sale to enhance their importance. A collector confided to the care of an expert, Monsieur F., a painting of a religious subject representing a scene from the Apocalypse. Giving this information, the owner asked the expert to put the painting up to auction at the first important sale. According to arrangement, Monsieur F. included the work among other canvases at a public sale and printed in the catalogue as a description of the subject, Tableau de Sainteté d'après l'Apocalypse. Sacred picture after Apocalypse. D'après l'Apocalypse? Questioned someone when the work was offered for sale, to which the unabashed expert promptly replied, Yes, sir, Apocalypse, a German painter not very well known in Paris but highly esteemed abroad. Another such catalogue, the product of a no less imaginative expert, announced a canvas on sale to be the portrait of Louis XV by Velázquez. A figure of a woman washing dishes, attributed, by the experts to Rubens on account of the exuberant rotundity of the model, needed perhaps a further justification for this daring attribution, for it was decorated with the following astonishing comment: "Portrait of Rubens' wife." It is generally known that Rubens married his cook. The recent mania of the collector to possess masterpieces has turned the experts to a most versatile form of activity in order to please this exacting fancy of the buyer. A painting becomes of the school of this or that artist when it is really too bad to bear even the uncompromising qualification attributed to so and so. It is difficult to tell when a man ceases to be an expert and becomes invested with the part of courtier, because in keeping with the general character of the various functions of the curio world, there is no definite and plain delineation between the one capacity and the other. The courtier is naturally supposed to know all about the trade, to possess the necessary elements for appreciation of artistic value, and to make others appreciate it. His chief mission, however, is to smooth over business difficulties that might arise between the seller and the buyer. As may be logically expected, the metamorphoses of this personage are infinite and may be useful or not to the collector according to circumstances. In conclusion, the go-between is not only often a necessary complement, but may at times be used to great advantage. The difficulty lies in knowing how to choose the right sorts. End of chapter 14.